Hello, this is Lakshmi Sairam, and in this video I'm going to discuss about deadlocks. In this video I'm going to discuss about deadlock definitions, understanding deadlocks, necessary conditions for deadlocks to happen, and something about resource allocation traps. Firstly, let's see the textbook definition of what a deadlock is. So the classic definition of what a deadlock is that deadlock is a situation in which every process in a set of processes is waiting for an event that can be caused by another processes in that set. Basically, what it means is that consider a situation here where we have some set of processes P1 to P5. Each of them is taking hold of a resource, and each of them are waiting for some other process or like for some other resource for their completion. Basically, what happens in this sort of situation is that if none of the processes are willing to give up on the resources for other processes' completion, then each of the processes would end up in an infinite loop. So the program would never halt. So the process would never halt. That was quite tricky. So let's see a classic example that has been used to understand this sort of situations and get a better understanding of what deadlock is. Consider this situation of dining philosophers. In this situation, we have five philosophers and five chopsticks. Each of them belongs to the respective philosophers. Basically, what a philosopher does is that he can think and he can eat food. This food is commonly shared among the philosophers. The goal of each philosopher is to think for some time, and then when he's done with his thinking, he feeds on the food, and then later again he thinks. So imagine a situation in which only all the philosophers are thinking, and all of a sudden P1 has got his idea, so he stops thinking, and now he's hungry, so he wants to take the food. So P1 will have P1 sort of owns chopstick C1, let's assume. So without any hesitation, he would pick chopstick C1, but he needs two chopsticks to eat, right? So he'll look out for his neighbors P0 and P2. Since P0 and P2 are thinking, they don't need their chopsticks C0 and C2 respectively. So any of them are willing to lend their particular chopstick to P1. So P1 happily takes the chopstick and he does his eating part, and then he goes back to his thinking stage. And similarly, maybe if even two of the philosophers simultaneously have to eat, it won't result in any problem. But consider a situation wherein all of the philosophers have to eat, that too simultaneously. Since P1 has only C1, he picks it up. P2 has C2. He picks it up, P3, C3, P4, C4, and P0, C0. But remember, we need two chopsticks to complete the eating process. So each of the philosopher waits for the other philosopher to complete his eating. But ultimately, none of the philosopher ends up eating. So they all get stuck in this infinite loop situation. So fundamentally, that's what deadlocks are. This is an example to depict what deadlock is. Considered two processes, process one and process two. And process one is assigned, and resource A is assigned to process one. So process one has hold of resource A and process two has hold of resource B. But for process one to complete its execution, it needs resource B. And for process two to complete its execution, it needs resource A. So they both are interlinked. Neither process one is ready to give away its process resource A to process two, nor process two is ready to give away its resource B to process one. So both are greedy about their resources. In this sort of situation, neither of them halt, or neither of them end up executing, and they get stuck in a loop, an infinite loop. This deadlock situation is different from starvation, because generally in starvation, it is not infinite loop. There is some certain period of time, even though the period of time might be quite long, but it is never infinite waiting time. But deadlock can result in such infinite waiting times or never halting situations for processes. So far we have seen what a deadlock is and had a very basic understanding of what deadlocks is. Now let's see the necessary conditions for when situations or interactions between these processes can turn out to be deadlocks. So basically there are four necessary conditions for the situation to become deadlocks. First is mutual exchange, the second is hold and wait, the third is no preemption, and the fourth is circular wait. We'll go through each of them briefly. Mutual exchange. So mutual exchange is a condition in which at least one resource must be non-shareable. What does that mean is that a resource or an instance of resource, we will just see later what an instance of resource means, should be non-shareable with more than one thread or process. What does that mean is that if resource, consider this example in which we have two threads, T0 and T1, and we have a resource A. So when T0 is holding resource A or utilizing resource A, it cannot be simultaneously assigned to T1. That is what mutual exchange mean, exclusion means, sorry. So if one of the thread, only one of the thread can be allocated to hold the resource and the other in the need of the resource must do it. So here T0 is allocated resource A. So T1 must wait for resource A or T0 to release resource A. The next is hold and wait. In hold and wait situation, a thread must be at least holding one resource and must be waiting for other resources that are being held by other threads for its execution. Consider this example where P1 is waiting for R1 and P2 is holding R1. So P2 is holding R1 and P2 is again waiting for some other resource, say R2. And similarly, P1 is waiting for R1, but it is holding the other resource R2. That is what is called hold and wait. The next scenario is no preemption. From our understanding of what CPU scheduling algorithms are and how they work, we have basically distinguished between what preemptive and non-preemptive mean. So I guess there is no need for me to discuss that now. So the resources must not be preemptive as a condition for that is a necessary is one of the necessary conditions for deadlocking. What does this mean is that resources cannot be resources can be released only voluntarily by the thread holding it, but we cannot forcefully take away the resources from a thread while it is utilizing it or in execution. Until unless the thread has released a particular resource, we cannot take away the resource from the thread. So consider a situation here where we have two threads, T0 and T1. I mean, visually we can differentiate, maybe some characteristic exists between T0 and T1 that can be compared, or in a sense we can say that T1 takes maybe some smaller amount of time, a shorter amount of time than T1, T0, or maybe or any such characteristic that can be used to distinguish them. But based on this characteristic, but once if T0 is allocated the resources, even though T1 requests for the resource, unless and until T0 releases the resources, even though T1 might be faster than T0 or any of such characteristics it might possess, we cannot give away the resources to T1 as long as the resource is being held by T0. So only when T0 is done with the usage of resources and it releases the resources, that is when we can allocate, or the T1 can be allocated to the resource. Until that time, T1 should be waiting. So that is non-preemption. It is no preemption. The next thing is circular wait. So in circular wait, a set of threads, it's a set of threads holding resources and waiting for resources being held by other threads in the same set. Circular wait implicitly depends on hold and wait. So these conditions are not necessarily independent. So again, consider the situation where this P1 to P5 processes form a set. So each of this process is holding a particular resource and it's waiting for some other resource. Like we have seen earlier that the hold and wait condition also says that a thread must be holding at least one resource and must be waiting for other resources. So whenever a circular wait condition is satisfied by the states of few processes and resources, we can give an assurance that the hold and wait condition is also satisfied by that particular combination of resources and processes. So these four necessary conditions are not independent of each other, they are not necessarily independent of each other. Now we'll be moving to resource allocation graphs. We'll be seeing what resource allocation graphs is. The resource allocation graphs are used to precisely describe the resource allocation using directed graphs. There is some terminology that's been used here. We have V, which is a set of vertices, E is the set of edges, and T is a subset of V. It's a set of threads. Generally, maybe threads are processes. Because in multi-core systems, it is usually multi-threaded processes rather than multiple processes running, right? So that's the way things are. So usually T is this threads are represented using circles, and the rectangles are used to represent resources. Earlier, I have talked about what an instance of resource means. As you can see here, the resource has few dots, three in this case. This three represents that the resource has three instances of itself. You can think it of like this. Consider a multi-core processor. Say it has four cores. So if you have a thread, and if you run the thread on any of the processes, the exact set of instructions that are there in the thread would get executed every time, right? So it doesn't matter in which thread, in which core you run the process, the instructions that are executing are the same, and the outputs that are generated are also the same. And each of these cores are similar to each other, right? So that is when we can call this cores are an instances of the CPU resources. In similar manner, we can have network interfaces. Say we can have two network interfaces in a machine, and can allocate the two network the one of the network interface to one thread and the other to other. Both of them are the exact same replicas of each other. That is when we can call them as instances of network interface. So any instances of resources, the idea is not just limited to network interfaces or CPU units, maybe file systems as well can have this instance of resources. So these are the basic units of that particular resource. And again, there are since the graph is directed, there are three possibilities. That is, either we can have a directed edge from the thread to the resource, which is a request edge. That means that the thread T1 is requesting for this particular resource. When we have a directed graph from the resource or the instance of the resource to the thread, that means it's an assignment edge. That means the particular thread is holding the instance of that particular resource, or it is utilizing that resource instance of the resource. And when there is no edge, that means neither T1 is wanting to get hold of that resource, nor it is holding that resource. So basically, in this thread and resource interaction, it is always from a no edge state. It goes to the request edge state, if you consider it a state where first a request is made, then the assignment is done, or some maybe probably some waiting stage is also there. And then after the assignment is done, the edge is broken. Consider this situation. We'll be seeing how we will be analyzing the whether the situation leads to deadlock or not. So we will be going through one by one the rules that we have earlier discussed, the four rules of mutual exclusion, hold and wait, no preemption, and circular wait, and see if this condition satisfies it, and if it satisfies, does this leading to deadlock. No preemption, since no preemption cannot be pictorially or visually represented, let us assume that the resources are allocated to the processes in a non-preemptive way. And as we can see that here resources R1 and R2 are having two instances of each other, and each instance is connected to just only one thread. That means the principle, the condition of mutual exclusion, that is a resource cannot be, at least one resource must be non-shareable. So here we have the resources R1 and R2 are non-shareable with more than one thread. Hold and wait. According to the hold and wait condition, a thread must be holding at least one resource and must be waiting for other resource. Though T1 and T2 satisfy this condition of hold and wait, T1 and T3 satisfy the condition of hold and wait, T2 and T4 doesn't satisfy this condition of hold and wait. We'll also see that this condition, this sort of diagram doesn't lead to a deadlock. Again, the condition of circular wait also, because circular wait also is not satisfied, because out of all this four set, out of the set containing these four threads, only two threads are depending on the resources of others, and T2 and T4 are not, because they are they already are holding the resource. So if we start working on this particular diagram and start from the point of view of T1, T1 has allocated an instance of resource R2, that's fine, but T1 is expecting a resource of an instance of R1 for its execution to complete. And similarly, T3 is also allocated a resource of R2 or R1, and it is expecting a resource, an instance of resource R2. And another instance of R1 is allocated to T2. Similarly, another instance of R2 is allocated to T4. So for T1, it has R2 and it is waiting for R1. But R1 is currently being held up by T2. I mean, an instance of R1 is held up by T2 and T3. So T2 is in waiting stage now. And similarly, T3 is also waiting for resource R2, and T1 is waiting for resource R1. After some time, when T2 and T4 complete their execution, they release their instances of resources R1 and R2 respectively. At that time, T1 can take control of the instance released by T2, and T3 can take control of the instance released by T4. Thus, after some time, they can complete their execution, not ending up at a deadlock situation. This is again another example which we are going to analyze to apply the four necessary conditions and check if this leads to deadlock or not. As said earlier, since non-preemption cannot be represented visually, we are just assuming that it is being followed. The principle of mutual exclusion is also followed, because each instance of a process, each instance of a resource is only shared with one thread. Hold and wait. The condition hold and wait is also satisfied, because if you can observe, T1, T2, and T3, all three are being are holding a resource and are waiting to hold another resource. So unlike the earlier diagram, hold and wait is satisfied here. Now coming to the circular wait. In circular wait, we want a set of threads or set of processes to be in hold and wait situation. If we consider the set of all the threads in this particular scenario, T1, T2, and T3, all of them are in hold and wait. So we can say that the set of threads T1, T2, and T3, the set of thread containing T1, containing T1, T2, and T3, are in circular wait, are satisfying the circular wait condition. So this sort of situation can lead to deadlock, or will lead to a deadlock. Let's see how it will lead to deadlock. So T1 is holding a resource of R2, an instance of resource R2, and it is expecting R1. And R1 is held by T2. Similarly, a resource, an instance of resource R2 is also held by T2, and it is expecting resource R3. R3 is held by T3, and it is expecting R1. So each of them has formed an interlocking relation, wherein either T1 or T2 or T3 has to give up on at least one of their resources, like in case of T2, it is holding two resources. So either of them should give up on at least one of the resources they are holding, or the only resource they are holding, for all three of them to terminate or execute and terminate successfully. Else all these three threads will never get terminated, and they will end up in an infinite loop, which is what deadlock exactly is. Thank you.